Hi everyone, welcome to topic 15b, urinary system. This is the second lecture of the two lectures on this system. And we have started learning about the four steps of urine formation, or these are the same as the four functions of nephron. And these are glomerular ultrafiltration, tubular reabsorption, tubular secretion, and excretion. This figure illustrates the four functions of the nephron. The four functions of nephron shown here again. This is the same as the four steps of urine formation. So what is glomerular ultrafiltration? This is a passive membrane transport process and the gradient is hydrostatic pressure. So blood comes at a very high pressure in the glomerulus, and it is because of this that water and solutes which are smaller than proteins would get filtered out through the glomerular capillary walls, and they would be collected in the cup-shaped Bowman's capsule. Proteins and blood cells are too big to be filtered out, so they stay in the blood. And this filtered, which is collected in the Bowman's capsule, the filtrate, it would be drained into the renal tubule. The first part of the renal tubule would be the PCT. This slide provides you an idea of the filtration fraction. If we think that 100% of the plasma volume that is entering in the efferent arteriole, how much is filtered out and how much stays back? Out of that 100%, 20% of the volume would be filtered out. That means that much would go into the Bowman's capsule. Rest 80% stays in the blood vessels and it would drain out through the efferent arterioles and go into the, stay in the circulatory system. Now, out of the 20% of the volume that gets filtered out, more than 19% of the fluid would be reabsorbed back into the blood. So that means it would move out from the filtrate back into the blood in the peritubular capillaries. So less than 1% of the volume would get excreted out to the external environment. That means more than 99% of the plasma that enters the blood returns to systemic blood circulation. The second step is tubular reabsorption, which means the peritubular capillaries would reabsorb or reclaim useful substances from the filtrate. And these useful substances are water, glucose, amino acids, ions, etc. Some reabsorption can be passive, but most is active. And most of the reabsorption would occur in the first part of the renal tubule right after the Bowman's capsule. That means it occurs in the PCT, or the proximal convoluted tubule. What are the materials that do not get absorbed? Usually the nitrogenous or the toxic waste products of the body. There are three main nitrogenous waste products. The first one is urea, which is an end product of protein metabolism. The second one is uric acid, which is an end product of nucleic acid metabolism. And the third one is creatinine, which is associated with creatine metabolism in muscles. The third step is tubular secretion, which is basically reabsorption in reverse. That means some materials would move out from the blood in the peritubular capillaries back into the filtrate in the renal tubules. And most of the times it's hydrogen and potassium ions and creatinine. So this process is getting rid of substances which are not needed by blood. And the materials which would be left in the renal tubule would then move forward towards the collecting duct and to the various, the calyces and the ureter, and tubular secretion is active transport. This is a summary diagram of the glomerular ultrafiltration, tubular reabsorption, and tubular secretion. We are done with the anatomy of kidney, anatomy and physiology, and now we are going to learn about urine. What are the features of urine? In a day, the human body produces about 1.5 to 2 liters of urine. Now, please keep in mind that urine and filtrate are different. Filtrate would contain everything that comes out of the blood plasma from the glomerulus into the Bowman's capsule, and it does not contain the blood cells or the proteins, while urine is what is the end product of the filtrate. So this is urine is what would remain after the filtrate has lost a lot of the water, ions, nutrients, etc. through reabsorption. So urine mostly contains waste products such as nitrogenous wastes and substances which are not needed by the body. Some physical and chemical features of urine. Urine appears to be yellow in color, and this is due to a particular pigment called urochrome, which is formed from the destruction of hemoglobin. That means when hemoglobin is broken down to be reused. Dilute urine would be lighter in color. As a urine gets more concentrated, it gets darker in color. Urine is sterile. That means there are no microorganisms in the urine. It gives out a mild odor, so it's slightly aromatic. The pH of urine is around 6, which is acidic pH. And the specific gravity, that means kind of like the density, is 1.001 to 1.035. What are some normal and abnormal constituents of urine? The solutes that are normally found in urine include the nitrogenous waste products, urea, uric acid, creatinine. In addition to these, there might be sodium and potassium ions, ammonia, which gives the smell, the bicarbonate ions, etc. The solutes which are not normally found in urine, which are abnormal constituents, are glucose, blood proteins, red blood cells, hemoglobin, white blood cells, or bile. This table gives you the list of some abnormal urine constituents and the name of the condition that is caused due to the presence of these abnormal constituents in urine and the possible causes. So let me give you some examples. For the first one is, if glucose is found in urine, then the name of the condition would be glucosuria, and the possible causes are too much of sugar intake, it is diabetes mellitus. If you see RBCs, so RBCs should not be present in urine, it's an abnormal constituent. If RBCs are seen in urine, then the name of the condition is hematuria, and possible causes could be bleeding in the urinary tract. If you see bile pigments in urine, the condition name would be bilirubinuria, and the possible causes would be hepatitis. Ureters. Ureters are two long slender tubes which come out from the kidney. So they drain the urine from the kidney and take it to the urinary bladder. And the ureters are continuous with the renal pelvis. The ureters enter the urinary bladder from the posterior side, and it is peristalsis that helps in the movement of urine in the ureters. This figure shows the two ureters coming out from the kidneys. The urinary bladder is a muscular sac-like structure, and its main function is to temporarily store urine. This sac can collapse and expand. An important part of the urinary bladder is known as the trigone. The trigone is a triangular region present at the base, that means at the inferior part of the urinary bladder. And this triangular structure is formed by three openings. Two of the openings are the ones coming from the ureters, so those two openings are called the ureteral orifices, and one opening is to the urethra. This is called the internal urethral orifice. In human males, the prostate gland surrounds the neck of the urinary bladder. This figure shows the trigone in the urinary bladder. This is a very important topic, histology of the urinary bladder wall. The urinary bladder wall is made up of four tissue layers. If we go from deep to superficial, the layers would be, the deepest layer is mucosa. So mucosa is the lining, is lining the hollow lumen of the urinary bladder. And mucosa is made up of mainly epithelial tissue. It's transitional epithelium. There are multiple layers of epithelial cells here, and this is known as urothelium. When the bladder is empty, you can see mucosal folds, which are known as rugae. When the bladder expands, the rugae flatten out. So rugae help in the expansion. The mucosa also includes a thin layer of loose areolar connective tissue, which is known as lamina propria. So the function of mucosa is to allow expansion, and it is the rugae and the transitional epithelium that are together allowing the expansion. The second layer is submucosa. And submucosa is made up of dense irregular connective tissue. It contains collagen, elastin, and other extracellular matrix proteins. The function of submucosa is it has blood vessels and nervous tissue which are supporting the mucosa. The third layer is muscularis. So muscularis means it has muscles. There is irregular smooth muscle, which in bladder is known as detrusor muscle. And this detrusor muscle or the smooth muscle forms internal urethral sphincter. The function of the muscularis layer is contraction of detrusor muscle, helps in the expulsion of urine. Continuing with the histology of the urinary bladder wall, the fourth layer is serosa or adventitia. If you look at the superior part of the urinary bladder, it is made up of parietal peritoneum, which is a serous membrane. So that is the outermost layer in the superior part. The function of the serosa is to protect against friction, that means rubbing against the organs. But the side walls, that means the lateral and the inferior wall of the urinary bladder, does not contain the serosa. Instead, it contains loose connective tissue, which is known as adventitia. And the function of adventitia is to connect the urinary bladder to the surrounding tissues in the pelvis. Finally, nervous tissue is also present in the urinary bladder. So bladder would receive innervation from both somatic, which is voluntary, and autonomic, which is involuntary nerves. Autonomic contains sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. The somatic nerve would innervate the external urethral sphincter, and the function of this somatic nerve would be to constrict, that means store urine, or relax, cause micturition, that means urine voiding. The autonomic nervous system, sympathetic and parasympathetic, would have different effects. Sympathetic nerves would relax the detrusor muscle, so it causes urine retention, while parasympathetic nerves would contract the detrusor muscle and causes micturition. This figure shows the histology of the urinary bladder wall. So what is the capacity of the urinary bladder? The urinary bladder is about the size and shape of a pear. When it is moderately full, it is 5 inches long and it can hold up to 500 milliliters of urine. However, if required, it can hold up to twice that amount, that means 1 liter of urine. The urethra is a small tube that is used to carry urine from the urinary bladder to the outside, so it is the tube that is used for micturition, and urine moves in the urethra by peristalsis. The release of urine is controlled by two guarding mechanisms, which are the two sphincters: the internal urethral sphincter, which is made up of smooth muscle, so it's involuntary, and the external urethral sphincter, which is made up of skeletal muscle, so it's voluntary. This figure shows the internal and the external urethral sphincters. Urethra gender differences. There are structural and functional differences in the urethra between males and females. First, let's talk about the length. The urethra is longer in males as compared to females. In females, the size is about 3 to 4 centimeters, while in males, it's 20 centimeters. Location. In females, the urethra opens anterior to the vaginal opening, while in males, it travels through the prostate gland and through the entire length of the penis. So in males, the urethra has three regions: the prostatic urethra, the membranous urethra, and the spongy or the penile urethra. Functional differences. In females, the urethra is used only to carry urine. But in males, the urethra carries both urine and semen, that means the sperm. This figure shows the male urethra. You can look at the three regions: the prostatic urethra, membranous urethra, and the spongy or the penile urethra. The urinary system is related to the fluid, electrolyte, and the acid-base balance in the body, because the blood composition in the human body depends on three factors. First, what the person is eating, that means diet. Second, the person's cellular metabolism, how are the things that are eaten are being metabolized. And third is the urine output. What are the things that are being excreted with urine and what are the things that are being retained in the body? The fluid, electrolyte, and acid-base balance in the body is maintained by kidneys in four ways. First, the kidneys excrete or eliminate nitrogenous waste products from the body, such as urea, uric acid, and creatinine. Third, in urine, the amount of water that goes out dictates the water balance of the body. Along with the water that is excreted in the urine, there are also ions or electrolytes being excreted, so urine is maintaining the electrolyte balance. And lastly, urine maintains the proper blood pH, that means it is regulating how much bicarbonate ions would be excreted out. The amount of water in human body varies. In young adult females, it's 50% of the body. Young adult males have more, 60%. Babies have the highest, 75%, while in elderly, it's only 45%. There is a link between water and salt. The solutes in the body are the ions, such as sodium, potassium, calcium ions. So whenever the ionic concentration changes in the body, water would move from one compartment to another, that means from one region to another. And whenever water moves, there is change in the blood volume and blood pressure, which can affect the cells. And remember that water follows the movement of salt. So how does the body or the urinary system maintain water balance? If there is excessive water intake, the urinary system would make dilute urine. If water intake is not enough, the body is getting dehydrated, then the amount or the volume of urine goes down, so the urine is more concentrated. Regulation of water and electrolyte reabsorption. This is mainly done by hormones. Remember, there are two important hormones. The first one is antidiuretic hormone ADH. An antidiuretic hormone prevents water loss, that means it prevents dehydration. It causes the kidneys collecting ducts to reabsorb more water. So in the absence of ADH, or if ADH is not working efficiently, there's a disease which leads to a large amount of urine being produced, and that disease is known as diabetes insipidus. Another hormone that regulates water and electrolyte reabsorption is known as aldosterone. This is secreted from the adrenal cortex, and its main function is to cause reabsorption of water and sodium ions. And plus, remember, water follows salt, so if sodium ion is moving, water will move. The regulation of water and electrolyte reabsorption is caused by a mechanism known as the renin-angiotensin mechanism, and this is mainly controlled by the juxtaglomerular apparatus present in the kidneys. So what happens is, when the cells of the juxtaglomerular apparatus are stimulated because the blood pressure is falling, so the low blood pressure would cause the release of an enzyme, which is the renin enzyme, and this is released into blood. Renin would go and convert angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 has two effects. It causes vasoconstriction, and it also causes the release of aldosterone hormone. Aldosterone hormone would go and it would cause the kidney cells to reabsorb more water and sodium ions. This leads to an increase in blood volume, and this would consequently increase the blood pressure. This figure summarizes the regulation of water and electrolyte balance by the urinary system. Normal blood pH is between 7.35 and 7.45, which is slightly alkaline. This is the blood pH required to maintain homeostasis. If the blood pH goes above 7.45, it is known as alkalosis. If it goes below 7.35, it is acidosis. This slide lists some important acids produced by the body, and most of the acid-base balance in the body is controlled by the kidneys. Blood buffers. Buffers are those molecules that react to stop dramatic changes in the hydrogen ion concentrations. That means they try to keep the pH at a constant level. So when they see that the pH is dropping, they would increase the pH. When they see that the pH is increasing, they would decrease it. And there are three major chemical buffer systems in your body: the bicarbonate buffer system, the phosphate buffer system, and the protein buffer system. So when the blood pH rises, the kidneys would retain hydrogen ions. So retention of the hydrogen ion would increase the acidity. Okay, because blood pH was rising, it means blood was becoming alkaline. And when the opposite happens, that means when blood pH falls, that means blood is getting more and more acidic, the hydrogen ions would be secreted.